Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you very much for coming. So I'm an archaeologist, and I work with material remains. And I know we have a large variety of people here, people who work in psychology, mathematical modeling, and all that. And so, you know, what I'm really hoping for is that when I present you the data, which are based on material evidence, and because we work in prehistory, in a prehistoric site, and various theories, that that you can give me some feedback on what I have on my thoughts. So the Me Too archaeological project started in 2004. We had five seasons of excavation and survey. And since 2009, we are studying our finds for publication. Me Too is located over here in central Greece. Our project is a collaboration between the University of Tennessee and the Greek Archaeological Service. The local branch is called the Archaeological Effort of Phtiotida and Eritania. And our work is sponsored by the American School of Classical Studies at Athens, which is one of the overseas research institutes, American research institutes. So we have fielded a lot of people because Me Too had never been excavated before we started, and the new antiquities law of Greece put a limit to how much you could dig. You could only dig for 5 years, and then you have to stop and publish. And so in order to expose a lot of the site, to have some story, some understanding, we started to field increasingly larger and larger teams, as you can see over here. And so ever since, we are studying the finds. Our finds are located in a lab not far from the island of Mitru, the site of Mitru. And so you can see our people here at work. We have at the moment over 13,000 inventoried objects, 900 crates of bulk finds, pottery, human bones, animal bones, plant remains, stone tools, textile tools, and architectural fragments. So we have a lot of finds, a lot of fun to study those. Our team is very active. We have a bunch of students who were finishing PhD students. They were very dynamic and wanted to publish a lot. So we have, between all of us, we have now 117 lectures that we presented at professional meetings, 33 scholarly articles, 4 more are accepted for publication. And we have 3 PhD dissertations, 5 MA theses, and 4 honors theses that we produced. The final publication is going to be a multi-volume report in print on every aspect of the site, but we also want to publish our data digitally, so our raw data digitally. So the reasons for excavating Mitru were twofold. One was that Mitru is located on the Euboean Gulf, which is this narrow passageway here, which was until the advent of mechanized ships, was the main passageway between northern and southern Greece. So in antiquity, you could expect that this was also the case then, and that so Mitru, that any sort of movement of people or trade would come via Mitru. Also by land, it is located actually on a narrow passageway over here, the Thermopylae that you may have heard of, where the Greeks held the Persian army at bay, is just a little bit further up here. So it's really an ideal place to see any changes passing by. Also, there was a survey that was done by Cornell University at the site, and they found that there were pottery fragments of almost the entire Bronze Age and a lot of the Iron Age. So basically, we knew there was uninterrupted occupation from early Bronze into the early Iron Age in calendar dates from about 2500, 2400 to 900 BC. So having such a long occupation was very promising. So here is are the people at work, and here is some of the pottery. And what really attracted me was that there was a lot of high quality pottery from the formative period of the Mycenaean Palatial Society, which was the first state-level society on the European mainland. And I was very interested, I'm very interested in the rise and decline of complex societies, so I thought this would be great to actually excavate a site that has a good record of this period. So, and indeed, our excavations have borne out that we have an uninterrupted occupation from about, you know, let's say, 2400 to 900 BC. And this allows us to study cycles of civilization. The Bronze Age on mainland Greece had sort of, you know, had periods of stability and periods of turbulence, and we can actually see the rise and decline of two main complex societies. You probably have heard about the Mycenaeans, but you may not know that a thousand years before the Mycenaeans, there was another complex society called the Corridor House Civilization. It probably reached sort of the chiefdom level. It's debated, but nobody would claim that it was as complex and a state-level society as the Mycenaeans. But it was a flourishing civilization, and it broke down around 2200 BC. For reasons that are very much debated. And we see a reversion to simpler societies in the period that we call early Helladic III. And when I say Helladic, think Bronze Age. That's the Bronze Age on the Greek mainland, is the Helladic period. So that's one period of transition that we were hoping to study. The next period was the rise of Mycenaean state-level society in what we call the pre-palatial period, and it goes from around 1600 to 1400 BC. In pottery terms, Middle Helladic III to Late Helladic 3a, 1 or 2. And we see in many parts of Greece, we see an elite arising. But until recently, we only knew this elite through their graves, because there were no well-preserved, well-excavated settlements from that period. So Mitru is the earliest settlement from this period that we have. And then the third period of transition is the fall of the Mycenaeans. Mycenaean state-level societies, I would say the breakdown of Mycenaean palatial society and breakdown of complexity, which happens around 1200 BC. And then you see sort of a slow disintegration of society, and by about 1075, 1050, we are in the Iron Age and we have again simple settlements. So that's sort of in a nutshell, sort of the cycles of civilization. So for instance, a leader in an Iron Age village lives in a hut a little bigger than everybody else's, while in the Mycenaean palatial period, he lived in a palace, surrounded by a citadel, well separated from everybody else. You had actually a hierarchical built landscape. Yeah. So today I'm going to talk mostly about those two periods. I will tell you maybe a little bit about these if there's time, but we actually have most of information about the first two periods of transition. So here is Mitru. Mitru is located in the North Euboean Gulf. There is the island. It's an island now, but in antiquity it was a low headland overlooking the sea. And so this part of the Gulf was mainland. And this, you can see the land bridge here, barely submerged. It was dry land, so it was a headland. It's in area about 3.6 hectares. The maximum height above sea level nowadays is 12 meters, but the site continues underwater on this side and on this side. So it was actually larger at the time. Now, when the Greek law of 2002, the Greek Antiquities Law of 2002 also restricted how much you could excavate, unfortunately for us. It said that instead of just renting parts or making agreements with landowners, you had to buy the land where you wanted to excavate. You could maybe make some little trenches here and there, but you couldn't do a systematic excavation like we would, like, you know, if you had total access, you could do trenches everywhere and get a sense of what's there. We couldn't, because the land was very expensive. And it's actually, the island is subdivided into 16 plots, and each plot belongs to two or three people, so it's very complex. So in order to get a sense of what was at the site and choose judiciously of where to excavate, we asked Grigoris Tsokas, a geophysicist from the University of Thessaloniki, to come and do a geophysical survey. And he came in 2003, the year before we started, and he surveyed with electrical resistivity the open area of the island, and you could see that there is, you know, there are various things. We thought this was maybe a big wall, and there is some row of rooms here, another wall over there. And then in 2005, he came back and did the olive groves here with differential magnetometry, and he found more sort of, I mean, it's a bit rougher, but he found what may be roads, and he also found what looks like a large complex over here. And the electrical resistivity survey suggests there was a large complex over there. So we decided to focus on those two areas. You might say, why are archaeologists always looking for elites? Well, they're the easiest to see because you only have so much time and it costs a lot of money, so you go for something you actually see. So those are our main excavation sectors, the northeast sector and the northwest sector. And then in addition, we did some small individual trenches in the northeast corner on the east scarp, and that's, I'll mention this trench several times, it's trench LX784, and then a small shallow trench over here. So in all, we have only excavated about 2.2% of the site's surface above the sea in 5 years with big teams. That's how slowly excavation goes nowadays, because the stratigraphy was very condensed. You had to dig very, very carefully. Actually, we just bought these two plots. There are two plots over here that we just bought, and we're now negotiating about this one. And I really would like to buy this one because that's where, yeah. Yes, it's everything goes slow. So in most of these trenches, and these you cannot see because the trees are in the way, but this gives you a sense of what this area looked like. Most trenches, we did not go deeper than the late Bronze Age, late Helladic, because the law also says that, you know, you cannot just dig what we call phone boots. deep trenches and sort of get a sense of the sequence, but not have a sense of the society at the time. So they say, no, you have to dig, you start from the top and you dig as much until you have a sense of what that settlement was like, and then you can go deeper. And that's what we did, and I think it's actually a good rule. So in most trenches, we didn't go deeper than the late Bronze Age, but in a few trenches, especially this one over here, and then one trench over here, we went all the way deep down. In this one, we went down to the end of the early Bronze Age, and in this one, we went all the way down to sea level, which brought us to early Bronze 2B, about 2400 BC. So we have a sense everywhere a bit of what the settlement looks like. Now, excavation doesn't give us much of an exposure in terms of extent, so we supplemented that by doing a very detailed surface survey in 2.5 by 2.5 meter grids. We basically collected everything, and each of these grids is a pixel. It's like a pixel, and the idea is to get a sense of the surface distribution of the material culture, and then compare it to what we excavate to see if what you find on the surface corresponds to what you excavate underneath. And I can tell you already that is the case most of the time. So we can actually, we have done 25% of the island with this detailed surface survey, and so we can actually use it to predict now what is underneath. And the main person who has done this is Caroline Bells over here, who has actually got her PhD with a dissertation on Roman mosaics. So I told her, it's like a mosaic, you know. Now, since the site became an island in a big earthquake of 1894, and the Atalante earthquake, and the sea since then has been eating away on the site, but that means that you actually have scarps created by the sea on the east and the west side of the island. And these scarps basically run through the settlement. And so we had three intrepid students, Lexi Kostik was an architecture student, documenting, cleaning and documenting these scarps, and then excavating layer by layer, and then documenting the whole thing again. So that gave us also a sense, this part here is actually over here, it's very hard to show the whole thing, but it gave us a sense also, it gave us long sections through the site. Each of these scarps is about 35 meters long. So in our excavation, and the tally is still going up, as of last summer, I have counted 62 occupational levels. So we have a very refined stratigraphy. We are still going through the stratigraphy with a fine tooth comb. That's why the tally keeps going up. And this has allowed us to study changes with an unprecedented level of detail. And our pottery people could use this stratigraphy to see how the pottery changed over time and develop a much more refined pottery chronology. These periods were already known. In the Middle Helladic phase, or the Middle Bronze Age, we had an Australian PhD student, Chris Hale, who was able to distinguish 7 different phases. I think we have 10 levels, but he was able to distinguish 7 pottery phases, so that we now can have a more refined relative chronology. And together with Salvatore Vitale, he subdivided the late Helladic I phase into 4 phases. In most areas of Greece, they only talk about late Helladic I, which is about 100 years. So we can now talk about maybe 25 years. So in most phases, from Middle Helladic to late Helladic 3C, we can talk about phases that are about 25 years. So that is really very, very good, a very good chronological resolution, archaeologically speaking. So when I was trying to understand the phenomena we see, the changes we see, I was actually at one of the AIA lectures that I hosted. We had a Bill Fowler from Vanderbilt came, and he talked all about practice theory, and I'd heard about it, but he really convinced me that that's a very good way of trying to interpret archaeological data. Because in archaeology, we see the physical remains, and the physical remains are the results of what people do. And when you find things a lot, you find a lot of the same sort of thing, you can start to say that these were people's habits. And their habits, their practices, are, according to Pierre Bourdieu, a sociologist, French sociologist, are the material or the expression of what he called habitus. And habitus is a very interesting concept. It's sort of a body of internalized notions that you have. Which guide your thoughts and your practices. And it's so ingrained that you think this is the only way of doing things. Like, for instance, when I eat with my knife in my right hand and my fork in my left hand, and I think that's the only way to do this. And I came in this country and, you know, everybody was holding their fork in the right hand. So it's a different way of doing things. So you can see habitus, you can see the social practices very well in the archaeological record. And then you can also see changes. So how do change then happen? How does change happen in habitus? According to Pierre Bourdieu, it happens through crisis, periods of crisis, when a group of people who have a certain habitus are confronted with another group. And then the 3 things can happen. Either people just stick with their own and say, no, ours is better or something. Or they adopt a new practice, or they change their practices to some degree. So that's how he sees it. And as I will show, I think we have actually, we can explain the changes that happen at the end of the corridor, how civilization at Mitru, I think we can explain in this way, but not the rise of an elite in the pre-palatial period. And for that, I am using Anthony Giddens' insight. And Anthony Giddens sees habitus in a more flexible way. He says it's more like language. And it's not like everybody always follows habitus and then they only change when they are confronted with something new. He says, no, there are individuals in a society that can use practices, can use habitus, and sort of use it as language and innovate and or change for their own reasons. And I think that is really what is happening in the In the prepalatial period, or the formative period of Mycenaean society. Another concept I will use is that of cultural capital, which is basically anything that gives a culturally distinct position. I think that this emerging elite at Mitru is using a lot of things as cultural capital to set themselves apart from the rest of the population. So let's start with the corridor house civilization. So it flourished around 2500-400 to about 2200 before Christ, before the Common Era, and it is the first complex society on the European continent. In terms of settlement hierarchy, we see a three-tiered hierarchy. There are towns with corridor houses, and those are the ones we have so far. Mitru may have one as well. So they're mostly in southern Greece, but we also have Thebes has one as well in central Greece. And then you have villages that don't have corridor houses, but are substantial settlements, and then you have hamlets as well. It's debated whether you reach a chiefdom level at this point, or whether these are more like big men societies. I rather think that these are chiefdom level societies for the reason that these corridor houses were actually quite stable. They persisted for a long time. So you have in each of these settlements you have a corridor house, and these corridor houses are official. They are planned officially. They're not like other buildings at the time, which are thin walled and sort of a little crooked and all that. These are quite. These are very regularly built with thick walls. They had two floors, and you have a fairly regular plan. There is always a reception room in the front, and then some other rooms in the back, and you have corridors to the side, which held staircases. That's why we call them corridor houses. So you have official architecture, you have the use of white lime plaster. For instance, this one over here at Colonna is called the Vices House, the White House, because it was white plastered, and the Austrian excavators. You also have a large circular heart. There can be separate clay hearts, like this one from Lerna, or they can be built in. And these buildings have roof tiles, baked roof tiles. These are also the first baked roof tiles in this entire area. And these roof tiles, the roof tiles and the large reception room with the circular heart are sort of symbols of power, because they will come back in the Mycenaean period where you have the same thing. You have baked roof tiles, you have reception rooms with large circular hearts. So this is 1,000 years before that. There was some sort of administrative control. We have the use of seals and ceilings, and it is thought that they functioned within a redistributive system. You had people bringing in taxes, and their contributions were recorded. And there was large-scale processing of food, like here is Lerna. You have more than 200 grinding slabs and grinding stones, much more than a simple family needs. So this was large-scale processing. And there seems to be evidence for feasting as well, where there may be, the people who pay their taxes may actually be the ones who were invited in, because they just would just fit in there, and then everybody else feasted outside. It is, a lot is still unknown about this civilization, but a very interesting article was written by Olympia Peperaki in 2010, where she sort of, she pulled all the evidence together from all these places and said, maybe we have here the ideology here that sustains this society is maybe the ideology of sharing. Yes, you bring your taxes here, but hey, look what a great feast, and we're all part of the same community. So, at Mitru, we certainly have this period, and we have evidence for this period in several places on the West Scarp, in the northeast corner, on the East Scarp, and especially here where we actually have excavated a large trench, about 30 square meters of it. So probably the settlement was all over, at least the northern part of the island, if not everywhere else. Over here we also have buildings, and the walls are very thin. Over here, we have very thick walls, and these are these lower walls over here. There are two superimposed buildings, and both have walls of about 70 centimeters thick, strongly built as well. Unfortunately, only small parts have been excavated because we have to expropriate this land in order to excavate the whole thing. But it's very promising. In fact, we have only excavated a small part over here and a small part over there. And what we found was, you know, we found roof tiles in a number of places, large roof tiles, which are, and actually there is a young scholar, Karl Jaswa, is doing research on these now, and he's finding that our roof tiles were probably made by the same people who made also roof tiles in one site in the Peloponnese. So he's starting to put together networks of craftspeople. So we have thick walls built with large stones, baked roof tiles, a lot of fine dining pottery, more than 25 grinding stones, many chipped stone tools, and this all come from these two places here. And then over here in the scarp, we found many large spindle whorls and thick, heavy spindle whorls, like they were weaving something heavy, like tapestry or something, but many. So we're making large threads, of course. So here are the two buildings, this is building N and this is building M on top of it. And that's all we have. So I don't dare to say we have corridor houses, but we could have. We also have a seal. And this was found by one of our team who has an eagle eye, spotted it in the sea, and it's a clay seal of, it could be from this period or just the next period. They continued actually in early Helladic III. So then, around 2200, we see the breakdown of this civilization. There are widespread destructions, but at somewhat different times, they're not all at the same time, and they're widespread throughout southern and central Greece. And then in the next phase, you see simple settlements. Gone are corridor houses and any evidence for social complexity. You get what often is called trans-egalitarian settlements, meaning they look egalitarian, but probably there was a leading household perhaps, or but we don't see it in the archaeological record. We see major changes in cultural practices, especially in architecture, and they're best documented at Lerna, which is a site in the Peloponnese as well, in southern Greece. For instance, here is Lerna in the corridor house period. That's their corridor house, the house of tiles. And this is the same place. This actually, when it was destroyed, they put a tumulus over it. Here is the tumulus, a little amount of earth. And this is what it looks like in the next period. And every color is a different architectural phase. Okay. So this phase here lasted maybe 100 years. This is 200 years, and you have 8 architectural phases. You can do the math yourself. It's about 160 years. 160 divided by 8, we have math whizzes here. It's about a generation. So we have a very different concept of what is a building, what's a house, presumably. So in this phase, houses lasted for a long time, and people built, if they needed another room, they built onto it. In here, there was a very interesting study done by Rebecca Worsham, 2015. She did a dissertation on this. She proposed that, you know, that each of these buildings may have belonged to one nuclear family. And, you know, when the children married and went out, and they would build their own house. And when the parents died, they would destroy the house. It's possible that they actually ritually destroyed each of these houses. So it's a very different concept, very different practice, very different habitus related to buildings. Yeah. Something else was noted in Lerna by Betty Banks, who published all of this only in 2013. She found the architecture very flimsy, and really flimsy. The first building, the oldest building that was built after the corridor house was destroyed, did not even have walls of mud brick, which is unbaked brick on stone sockles, which is how people built before that. It was built with wattle and daub. Do you know what wattle and daub is? You know, wattle is the branches that you put poles and you weave with branches. You weave a wall, and then the daub is the clay that you slap onto it. That's wattle and daub. So the first building was actually built like that. Okay. In the next phase, they built mud brick buildings again, But they put the mud bricks straight on the ground, which is a very bad idea, because the moisture comes in when it rains, and you know, building doesn't last very long. Then in the next phase, they put a stone base, but only one row of stones, which doesn't protect you too much either. And then it's only in the next phase that they build a proper stone circle. That is curious. I mean, before that, they built corridor houses. Yeah. So Betty Banks made this very, very, I think, very interesting remark. She said, it appears that they had to learn to build walls all over again. How can this be the same people? So she suggested, these are new people coming in, and Jerry Rudder also suggested that. Now, this was a big controversy, because in the Aegean, a lot of people are still very, very wary about this, the old-fashioned way of seeing new people coming in all the time, each time there is a cultural change, right? So there has been this reaction since the late 60s and 70s that no, cultural change can be just local, can be indigenous. Well, I'm starting from our work at Mitru and from reading this, I am now really in this camp. I really think that we are having a new people coming in. So this is the case. This is sort of the example of where Pierre Bourdieu says that the habitus changes when you're confronted with the new people. Oops, sorry. I don't know what happened. Okay, sorry, I hit the wrong button. We also see changes in the pottery, and it's not just a change in pottery shapes, which can be a fashion that changes. We also see a change in pottery techniques. We get the pottery wheel that comes in. Pottery is now wheel fashioned instead of handmade. We see new surface finishes, gray burnished or dark burnished, and dark slipped and burnished. And those, the potter's wheel, we think, came from Anatolia, because before that it was only known in Anatolia, and also these finishes as well. There is also some dark on light decoration and light on dark, which may be local, so there is some continuity as well. Many of the new shapes look Anatolian. They have these double-handled bowls and cups, which before that you only find in Anatolia. We also see dramatic changes in the cooking pot repertoire. We get new kinds of cooking pots. Wide-mouthed jars, cups, perforated cups, you see one here. No more baking dishes, like you have here. No more stands either, like over here. So new ways of cooking. And that's, in archaeology, that is now well established that, when you have a new way of cooking, maybe that means something drastic. You don't just throw your old ways overboard and adopt a new way. We also may have new symbols of status. You get some unusual cups at Lerna. Like this one, there is a stone cup as well. This is actually a large vase. It's about this big. Very unusual, we don't know what it was used for. So there is a lot of change, a lot of change. We don't know whether there are changes in the burial practices, because unfortunately we have very few burials from this period. So in terms of cultural break, this is the most dramatic cultural break in the whole of Greek prehistory. It is huge. And the reason has been much debated. So Jack Caskey from the University of Cincinnati, who excavated Lerna, he noticed that, and he said, this is a new people coming in, invasion by a new people. He was very much, very traditionally trained, and saw then a new people, saw invasions. And he linked this invasion to an old theory by Carl Haley and Blagan, who had posited that Greek-speaking people had not lived in Greece since time immemorial. They had come in at some point, because the Greek language has pre-Greek elements in it that are not Greek. Names of mountains, names of places, are a number of them are not Greek, they're pre-Greek. So Caskey said, this is maybe when the Greeks come in, and they come in as an invasion, and they come in from the north. Everything new came from the north at the time. The problem is that you don't see one wave of destructions. You don't see people coming in and just destroying everything. You know, and this was a dissertation by Jeanette Forsen. She said the destructions are taking place over a prolonged period of time, and you get new features from many different regions, not just from the north, but from Anatolia, as I showed as well. And so this is not consistent with an invasion by a single people. Jerry Rudder proposed that you might have Anatolian immigrants coming in, blending with local people, and this happened peacefully in central Greece, where you have less destruction, and then maybe violent in the Peloponnese. The problem is, people in Anatolia knew how to build walls. And at Lerna and at Mitu as well, as I will show, we don't, the architectural knowledge was lost. If there is a new people coming in, they all of a sudden didn't seem to know how to build strong walls. So that doesn't fit either. So another possibility, the one that I favor, is that there may have been a breakdown of this complex society for various reasons, perhaps for internal reasons, perhaps, and we know that it was a breakdown of the Anatolian trade network at this time. And so perhaps, you know, that caused upheaval, caused problems. There's also some evidence for drought in the East Mediterranean. So for some reason, the society broke down, and when a society like that, an organized society breaks down, there is opportunity for outsiders to come in. And I think something like that is rather took place. So at Mitru, we see similar cultural changes as at Lerna, and we see some more. We have some more evidence for changes in practices. In early Helladic III, so just after the fall of the corridor houses, we have not identified any walls. Remember, we have only one trench here. But we have many floors, and there could have been walls. We may have missed them because we were looking for stones. We were not looking for wattle and daub. But what we see then is when we have walls again, which is at the transition to the Middle Bronze Age, these walls are very flimsy. They're very weak. So these are walls built with small stones, and the stones don't even touch. This is the view from above over here. In fact, the core here is about a third of the entire wall. I call this my type 1 walls. So the wall faces do not interlock, which makes the wall quite weak. And then when you look at the next phase, which is Middle Helladic one early, they start to have stronger, larger stones in their lower course of the wall, and they start to come closer together, but they don't interlock. And then in the next phase, they put larger stones in the entire wall. So they're starting, just like at Lerna, they sort of slowly learn how to build strong walls again. And then if we look at Middle Helladic II early, we start to see, and that's this one over here, we start to see the stones interlocking again. And this is what I call type 2 walls. And over time in the Middle Bronze Age, in the Middle Helladic, they start to use bigger and bigger stones, make stronger and stronger walls, and that you can see that over here. And here you can see it as well. So it's not just a question of optical illusion. This is actually a side view where you can see this is the lower wall, and then the higher walls have larger stones. Another new architectural feature that we see after in the beginning of the Middle Bronze Age at Mitru is that you get these very dramatic slopes inside houses. You wonder, how could you live on a slope like that? I mean, it's not too dramatic, this is a little exaggerated, but still, it's sort of a slope. And it reminds me a lot of modern Greek sheepfolds, which you put everywhere. You know, they don't level the ground, they just sort of put them on the hill slope. So all of that suggests that this was, you know, these buildings were not meant to be very strong, they were just sort of meant to be rather temporary and flimsy. Another change I noticed at Mitru is that there is a change in where the entrances are. In early Helladic IIb, in the corridor house civilization, the entrances tend to be towards the side. So you go to the side. And sometimes you have to sort of weave through the building. In the Middle Bronze Age at Mitru, they're in the entrances are close to the center or in the center of the wall. And then I looked at all the other architecture from this period, and it is the same. In the corridor house period, and even in early Helladic I, you get sort of more complex, you get entrances that are close to the wall or at the wall, and you sort of have to bend. Like here is, for instance, the corridor house at Lerna again. In order to go in here, you have to, you know, take turns, okay? While in the early Helladic III and the Middle Bronze Age, it's straightforward. So you have the entrance in the center, and you go, it's like what they call the gunshot house, right? So you go, you have a straightforward, so it's a very different understanding of a house, of how a house is organized. And you come in and you expect something very different. And so to me, that also means these are not the same people anymore. Why would they change something basic like that? And then Kyle Jaswat discovered a whole bunch of other changes from early Helladic II to middle Helladic I. He found, for instance, that the formula for building making mud bricks had changed. You get new darker clay matrix, you use straw temper instead of mineral temper, different kinds of inclusions. And this would have been invisible to the onlooker because you would have smeared it with clay. So this is not to make a statement, or you don't change it because you think it's aesthetically more pleasing. So this is, why would people change the composition of mud brick? So he suggested that this was the kind of thing that it's sort of an under the radar change in practice, and people at the time would have, you know, they built their houses, presumably there were families who built their own houses, so you learned it from your parents, your father presumably, you learned to make mud bricks, and so why would you all of a sudden have this change? And so that also, it suggests that there is a change in population. Of course, you have no more roof tiles, you now have reed and clay hipped roofs, you start to have wall plaster on the inside, tin plaster slip, and a new feature is that we have built hearths with tiles or pottery fragments, tile pottery fragments or pebbles. So you get a new feature like that. We also have a new kind of storage feature at Mitru, and that is this bin, sort of a mud brick bin. And this feature seems to come from northern Greece, where they had them before. They were still used in Thessaly in the 1970s when the Germans were excavating in Thessaly. And these bins were always there a meter and a half high. So if it was this high, it would have held 500 liters, which could have fed a family of 5 to 6 people for 6 months. So it's an important feature. We also start to see at Mitru, already in early Helladic III and also in the middle Helladic, we see storage pits built in the house, and they're built through layers of clay, so they are anaerobic storage pits. This is not such a new feature in Greece because it was already known before in the corridor house period as well. So if we put all of that together, we can say there are many, many changes in architectural practices, many changes in the concept of buildings, and apparently a loss of knowledge of how to build strong rubble walls and wall sockles. You don't forget something like that, you know. So this is why I agree with Betty Banks and with Jerry Rudder that you may have had the new people coming in here. I don't think it happened everywhere, because I looked at other areas of Greece. There are areas of Greece where the transition is very smooth or where there is very little change. So I would think that in some settlements, new people just replaced the older ones or became predominant, like at Mitru and Lerna, and this is an example of Bourdieu's crisis. And in other settlements, you may have had peaceful assimilation, or perhaps the newcomers didn't come at all. So I think this is a more a better understanding of this, of what is happening in this period. So it's a mix of things. So going into the Middle Bronze Age, then Mitru, the Mitru settlement, we have found Middle Bronze remains again all over the northern part of the island. The southern part is too low, it's underwater, so we don't know what happened there. But presumably at least the northern part of Mitru was occupied with a settlement, and it was sort of what you could call a rural settlement, with narrow streets where people threw their trash. We found large animal bones, lots of pottery fragments, just in the road. I mean, if they threw it with the meat, it must have smelled to high heaven. You know, so narrow roads about maybe a meter wide, something like that. People also constantly were patching their floors, and this is we know this through micromorphological analysis. So they were constantly relaying floors, so you get a quite rapid rise of floor levels. So to all, you know, we of course know not that much about this settlement, but it seems like it was just like in other areas of Greece, these settlements were really quite simple in the Middle Bronze Age. Burial practices also are similar to what we see elsewhere in Greece, where people would bury the dead in simple pit graves or cist graves. A cist grave is like a little box. And they buried them in the ruins of abandoned houses, and then later on they build on top. And then when the house was ruined for some reason, then they put again burials. So you get this alternation between habitation and burial phases in the same location. Then about 200-300 years later, if you fast forward, you have a state-level society on the Greek mainland. Mycenaean palatial society, where we know we have a hierarchical society with a king, the Wanax. We have aristocrats, we have middle class, and we have a lower class, more or less. And we know this from Linear B text. We now have writing. We know it also from architecture. I mean, this is clearly where there's the Palace of Mycenae with the citadel. And you have some aristocratic houses. You can actually, a typology has been made of Mycenaean buildings, and you can see it maps really nicely onto what we have from the Linear B texts. Also, the tombs suggest that there is a hierarchical society now. And the elite was warlike, and they are what we call networked, meaning that they sort of separate themselves from their own population, and they have contacts with each other. So how did we get there? And that is the pre-palatial period. Until recently, until we started working at Mitru, this period was not well known at all. Because, you know, the settlements were either poorly preserved or poorly excavated a long time ago. So at Mitru, we had the chance to excavate for the first time a well-preserved settlement from this period with modern means. And we have discovered a lot of new things that we never guessed we would find. We found that in Mitru, the whole thing starts at the very beginning of Late Helladic I, Late Helladic I, phase one. And we see, to all intents and purposes, it's a political elite that constructs materially a new ideology of power. We see a whole bunch of new things materially which seem to reflect a new ideology of power where the elite is elevated above everybody else. They separate themselves from everybody else. At times they bring new practices in, they break with the past, at times they subvert existing practices. And so I think here, I think Giddens's idea here of human agency that causes change and uses practices fits best here to explain what happens. For instance, one of the things we noticed is that the settlement organization changes drastically. Instead of having these narrow dirt roads, we get a number of long, wide roads in the settlement, and they meet each other at right angles. And here is road one, road two. This is road one. We dug into it to see what was below it, but this is road one. 3 meters wide, each of them are. We have two more over here, and then this one is from late Helladic II, so this is from like the 15th century, 2B. So, but you can see that these are exactly parallel as well, and there is probably more that we have not been able to get. So very different, the settlement must have had a very different appearance with these roads. And these roads were carefully paved with plaster, with pebbles, and then covered with mud plaster, and then with a layer of white plaster. So they were gleaming white. And they were kept meticulously clean, and you can see that already. This is level upon level. They were relaid a lot. They were kept clean, spotless. Very different from, you know, they must have had sort of, you know, it's somebody compared it to like the Boulevard Haussmann in Paris, changing the whole appearance of Paris. Takis Karkanas, who did micromorphological analysis on road 1 and road 2, noticed that they were extremely well preserved. And he said these roads were not used for normal traffic, normal foot traffic, because you can still see the white lime plaster. So I suspect that these roads had restricted access and had specific use, perhaps a ceremonial use for the elite. And I'll tell you more why. In addition, we have also two elite complexes that are built in this period. These are the big ones that we saw already in the geophysical survey. This one we call Building H and this one Building D. We have only excavated parts. This is because of the trees. And then this one is the reach here the limit of our excavation plot. There is more. But this is a very big plot, very expensive to expropriate. So you get elite complexes which create a hierarchical landscape, not just a highly organized new settlement, but a hierarchical landscape where some buildings are much bigger. And they're not only larger, they're also taller. And here again, an analysis of the mud bricks by Lee Anderson, who got his MA here. This was part of his MA in anthropology. He noticed that at this time you have in buildings H and D, you have two kinds of mud bricks. You have a bimodal distribution in terms of the density of inclusions. You get 5% or 15% to 20%. And then in one building over here, which is not elite, you have 5%. So he suggested that what you may have here is that the mud bricks of the lower floor, of the ground floor, had to be stronger because they had to carry the upper floor. So you may have evidence here for two floors. And this sort of fits with what Kyle Jasba found, and he found no longer evidence for reed roofs, which you find the reed impressions on the clay, but he found evidence for flat roofs or second floors. So these two buildings probably were two levels high. So I'm now actually working with an architect, Darius Corajon, to create videos of this, of how what the effect would have been for people, of people who lived there and visitors, to visit this late Helladic I town versus the middle Helladic town. So it would have been, this is still work in progress, so I don't think they were white here, but there would have been these white buildings, probably lined with walls, which were only for the elite. And the elite is going with a chariot, as you will see. And so you have, even from afar, you could have seen that this was a hierarchical settlement, no longer a simple settlement. And as I will show, the landscape also was imbued with inequality. The simple people could not come on these roads. And there were all sorts of social codes as well. So this is sort of what you could call a landscape of power. And we see also in the architecture that there is a development towards stronger walls. They're starting to use even larger stones. And now some of the walls have these bridging stones so that between the two faces so that they're even stronger, perhaps to carry the two floors. And in building D, which is built a little later in phase three, we actually have for the first time what we call megalithic architecture, architecture with large stones. And you only find it here, only in building D. Now, where did this idea come from? Or could it come from somewhere else, or did they develop it themselves? Because there was this development towards larger and larger stones. Maybe this is just a natural development. Well, actually, appearance of the megalithic architecture at Mitru is not so different from what it looks like at the site of Aya Irini on the island of Kea, which is not too far from Mitru, just at the southern end of the Euboean Gulf. And then if we look at Aegina, which was a main trading town at this time, they already had, since the early beginning of the Middle Bronze Age, they already had developed this sort of architecture, especially by Middle Helladic II early. So I suspect that our people knew about this because they were in trade contact with these two places and that they knew about it and were imitating them. Aegina was actually, it's sort of like a big, like you could call it a merchant republic of the Middle Bronze Age. It developed in the course of the Middle Bronze Age a large maritime trade network, and it reached also Mitru and even now the area of Lamia over here. And so through this trade network, Irina was part of it as well, we may have learned about this sort of this megalithic architecture. But what's interesting is that at this time, sorry, yeah, okay, I have to wind down. Oh. At this time, and nothing is ever simple, because you could say, oh, they just learned it and they took it over. No, because at this time, in the beginning of the Late Bronze Age, Late Heladic I, Phase I, we see the imports declining. In fact, there's almost no imports. So it's, and this is when our settlement is reorganized. Pottery imports start picking up again, very, very little, by Phase III, and that's when we get the megalithic architecture coming in. So I think there is something more at work than just, you know, some leading family at Mitru saying, oh, we want to increase our status, and we're just going to do what people in the southern Aegean do. I think they actually did only so at a more advanced phase. I think in the beginning, in Late Heladic I, Phase I, now that we can separate these phases, it seems that the Mitru's elite rejected the influence of this out of these other areas and developed its own indigenous elite culture. And only by Phase III, they start to say, okay, yeah, no, we like this, we like that. So it's the rise of this elite is not just sort of an wholesale importation of ideas from elsewhere, but it's a mix of the two. And so that's another takeaway. I think that the dynamics of secondary state formation are complex. It's a give and take between local tendencies and outside influences. And so, for instance, these long roads with restricted access are a typical Central Greek feature. You don't find them in southern Greece. For instance, near Mitru, there is another site on a hilltop which has fortification walls and has very long roads as well. It has not been excavated, so we don't know the date. It could be Middle Bronze Age, but I suspect it's from this period, and that's based on the pottery. And at Dimini in Thessaly, we actually have a settlement from the palatial period, Mycenaean palatial period, with a palace over here, and they have the same thing. And here it is clear that the roads had restricted access. They were lined with walls, and only the people from the palace here had access. And here they actually have the wheel ruts for the chariots. Okay, I'll quickly skip over this. Some other elements that come in other elements that our elite is adopting as part of a sort of its elite architecture are like gleaming white plaster floors. Which we get in Building D and then later also in Building H. And I did again a study, and you find them before this and elsewhere only in elite contexts. Also in terms of burial practices, at the beginning in Late Heladic I, Phase I, we see a first attempt by our elite to try to elevate themselves in burial, in death, by just making a bigger tomb than everybody else's. But then in the next phase, they import a new kind of tomb, which is a built chamber tomb, which they set inside Building D. And what's interesting is that at the same time, other people stop burying in the ruins of their own compounds, in their own family plots. And we don't know where they bury the dead, but we suspect that it is that there was a communal cemetery here, a permanent communal cemetery here. So people could no longer build in their own compounds, but they had to bury over here, while this elite now is burying the dead in their own compound. Yeah. And perhaps they are sort of basically subverting Middle Heladic burial practices by doing that. I don't know how much time I have. Yes, I'll wrap it up. So more elite architecture as well. More elite trappings, purple. They produce purple dye, which they probably used for their own clothes. They start now also to import increasingly more and more pottery from the southern Aegean. And from sort of late Heladic to a at the 3A onwards, they become more and more what we call Mycenaeanized. They start to adopt the elite culture from Mycenae. So, here's another thing. They develop also an elite cuisine. The physical, the buildings that they use and their clothes and all that are elite. Also, what they're cooking is elite. And we even have evidence for them running around in chariots, because this is actually a bridal piece which has been reworked with serrated edges. That's the sort of thing you find when horses are pulling chariots. And we also have evidence that our elite was warlike. We actually have parts of boar tusk helmets. We have arrows as well. Okay, I think I'll wrap it up here. So I think our work has demonstrated that these pre-palatial elites were not just warriors, which is what often was said, because before this we only had them in tombs, these elites, and they were warlike and all that. And so people were saying, well, maybe these are just rough warriors, and then they were civilized by Minoan Crete. That's often been said. Well, we see here at Mitru that we have a local elite that's not just warlike, but they're actually changing their settlements. They are what you could call urban planners, aware of the ideological effects of a landscape of power. And they develop all of this before they are in contact with Mycenae. And they even do it at the point that they reject the contact with Aegina. And they certainly are not in contact with Minoan Crete. So the idea that civilization sort of moved from the east and then it came to Crete and then it came to the mainland is sort of a wrong idea. The development towards complex society was much more an interplay between local tendencies and local human agency, you could say, and outside contacts which gave people ideas. Okay, I think I'll stop here. Thank you very much for your attention.
Does anybody have any questions?
Thanks a lot for your interesting presentation. I was very particularly impressed by how you reconstruct social changes based on material evidences.
Mm-hmm. It's hard.
Like, house design, a road, or even, roof tiles. Yeah. It's for us social scientists.
Yeah.
Very unusual approach. So my question is about the reasons. Mm-hmm. The reasons of why one stage, one type of civilization was changed by the other one. For example, when you are speaking about shift from corridor house civilization to so-called egalitarian civilization, you refer to Bourdieu theory about crisis as a meaning gene. And as this crisis, you defined invasion. You spoke about invasion of some, aliens or whatever, or, as you said, influx of newcomers.
Yeah, or mobility, new people coming in, but not a large scale.
So my question is, does it mean that the major factor or major reason of change or shift from one type of civilization to another that you describe was mostly external factors, because both invasion or influx external factors.
Yeah.
Now, I'm a little bit surprised because, when we speak about modern history society, most of social change grew up from inside.
Yes.
It's economic development, technological or change in demography. And, I can imagine when you speak about shift from corridor house civilization to egalitarian, that some, nomadic tribes came from north, as you mentioned, they were less civilized. That's why, they were interested in more simplification. It's clear. But when you mentioned again, when this civilization shift to Mycenaean, it's again hierarchy, again high culture.
Yes.
Could we speak about external fact, external reason again? I hardly imagine that some more civilized came there and introduced more.
Actually,
so my question about the reason.
It has been, thank you very much, it's a great question. It actually has been suggested when the pre-palatial elite was first discovered, when people started studying it more seriously, it had been suggested that these are also people who come from the north, right? And bring the chariot and bring chaffed graves and bring all these things, but that's, we can definitely say it's not the case. There is too much continuity. at that point. In the pre-palatial period, there's too much continuity from the Middle Bronze Age. And there are elements we see then which already were there before. For instance, these elite graves, one type of elite grave is a shaft grave. It's these deep shafts in the ground that you see at Mycenae, at some other places. It's not new, because they already had it before. They had it at Aegina before. So that is, and also we see when we study cultural practices, we see a lot of continuity in cultural practices. So I think there what you have is individuals who want to have more power. And we're wondering why, and in fact, I didn't get to this, but Josef Maran, a German scholar, in 2011 wrote a really provoking, thought-provoking article suggesting that, first Aegina and the islands, and then the mainland, more and more, came into contact with Minoan Crete. And he suggested that Minoan Crete were not just peace-loving flower pickers, but they were actually warlike. When we see images from Crete, especially their wall paintings and all that, it all is very peaceful, but that doesn't mean the society was peaceful. And he suggests that, in fact, to the outside world, Minoan Crete, they were warlike. They had a navy, they were establishing control. And so it's that face, the warlike face of Minoan Crete that the people on the mainland may have seen and may have reacted to. And perhaps it was these elites who were leading their own people in resistance against the Minoans. And then, this is more in southern Crete. In central Crete, it would have been Aegina. And so perhaps that's what gave them sort of the impetus. It's always hard to know, because we only have the physical remains. But they are imitating, in Mycenae, for instance, they are in Pylos, they're imitating the Minoan Cretans a lot, but being warlike.
Yes.
Yes, 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 yes. In fact, I took one time a class with, I was auditing a class with David, The Rise of Complex Societies, where at some point we were talking about, primates and, children in kindergarten, and there are always people who try to lord it over others, So, but I think it's different at the end of the Corridor House civilization, because there is, in so many ways, there is really a break, but not everywhere. Not in every place. So I see more, and I think it's a people that comes in who is just not used to building strong structures, like shepherd people or something. Like, for instance, you have now the Sarakatsani in Greece, or the of the Vlachs, who until the Second World War were living in very flimsy structures because they were moving a lot. They were moving in the summer, they were moving up in the mountains with their flocks, and in the winter they came down. So it might be something like that, so people like that who come in. But there is other things too. There is definitely an Anatolian connection too.
Anyone else?
Just one quick remark, and you can either take it and run and not bother responding to it, or whatever you want to do. One thought I'm having is that there could be change that comes along because people are doing more division of labor, so that rather than, everybody building their own house, for example, they start, if you build my house, I'll, grind your grain or whatever, yeah. So that could at least partly explain some of the erosion of expertise that you noticed. Maybe not, but it's a thought. That's another sort of route to change that it hasn't been, that you haven't discussed, either the external people coming in or,
It's a thought. It's a thought. And in fact, I strongly believe in what Kyle Jaswa is doing. He's really looking at networks of knowledge, of craft knowledge. And that is what will tell us whether everybody built their own house or whether they actually had a... there was really one same concept that you see in all these places. The problem is that in many early Bronze Age sites, they're not excavated over a large area. Lerna is the only one, because at that time you could just remove layer after layer. Now you can't remove anything anymore. So, those mud bricks are, I don't think they were kept. So, but it's an idea, but... But there, where you have a large area that was excavated, it is clear it's all over the area that the knowledge of building strong walls was lost. So I think there's something more going on.
Okay, we have time for one more, but then we'll close it up, and then Elatus will be here afterwards as well. But Barbara, my colleague, Barbara Heat.
Thanks. Sorry, does the bioarchaeology give you any help on in terms of understanding where people are coming or going?
I wished. We are working on it. We actually have a little baby from early Helotic 3, but very, very poorly preserved. And then, we have a number of our Middle Bronze Age tombs and all that, and later. So we hope to get to it through maybe DNA analysis, but the DNA is not preserved very well. But isotope analysis and biodistance studies. But the database, we're still building up the database for Greece. Bioarchaeology in Greece is really coming up now, but we have not reached the point where we can really say what the isotopic signature, for instance, of the different areas of Greece is. We don't know yet. No. But that's of course, that will be very helpful.
Okay, Dr. Van de Mortel, let's give her a big hand.
Thank you.